how long does it take the environment to change gene expression, epigenetics, and genetics?
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind, or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first, and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
Jeff Huseby says, can environment change gene expression, SNPs, et cetera, within one lifetime? In other words, if you didn't have a SNP in a certain gene early in life, could you develop one later on, say, as a result of extreme chronic stress? Correct answer probably is that it takes hundreds of years, but I thought maybe we had more science on it now. Well, generally speaking, environment mediates. I mean, it depends what you mean by environment mediating, right? So environment mediates changes in gene expression through epigenetics. But gene expression is not SNPs. SNPs are are produced through mutations in the heritable genome. By environment changing, do you mean the production of the mutation that is the SNP for the first time, or do you mean the change in the proportion of the population? So environment will change your gene expression, which means the epigenetics in your lifetime in you, and there may be some limited heritability of that that might last up to generations if environment doesn't reverse it. But environment's going to be a lot more likely to change lasting things during development or during pregnancy and nursing in the mother. But changes in gene expression happen over the course of minutes sometimes, and generally hours and days all the time. So environment's constantly changing your gene expression on a micro scale of hours to days and maybe weeks. But that doesn't last. That's, you know, the type of gene expression change that can happen over hours to days to weeks, or especially days to weeks to months, is the type that can be reversed in the same time frame by the environment. So that's generally going to be more responsive to cycles in the environment. Fasting feeding cycle is an example. Seasonal changes in macronutrient availability is another example. Seasonal changes in sunlight is another example. If you're going to produce lasting epigenetic changes that are semi-heritable, then that's probably going to be driven by things that were sufficiently developmental to make your body perceive that it's going to last generations. And a famine is a great example of that. Now, the environment, of course, is going to dictate gene mutations, because it's going to dictate the type of stress, such as oxidative stress and things like that, that could damage DNA and make it mutate. Evolutionary theory talks about gene mutations being random, but they aren't random, and evolutionary theory never meant that they were random. It meant that they were random with respect to the environment's demand for the environment's imposed fitness level of that genetic mutation. In other words, like Darwinism being correct as opposed to Lamarckianism being wrong, as taught in high school science classes, means that the reason genes mutate is not directly a result of the fact that they would be more fit to be in that environment. But there's got to be at least some exceptions to that, a minimum being that when you express a gene more often, that the chromatin structure will be more open because you have more things coming in to read the gene and make proteins out of it. Whereas when you express the gene less, the chromatin structure will be more tightly wound because you don't need to express the gene. And I can't fathom that that would not affect more highly expressed genes being more mutated more often than less expressed genes. So, you know, while it's probably not true that the giraffe stretching its neck is what makes the neck longer through successive generations, it probably is true that genes that are in high demand to be expressed often are the ones that are more likely to accumulate more mutations and thus accumulate a higher amount of genetic variability that accumulates more opportunity to be acted on by natural selection. And then the process of natural selection takes generations. So if this is in bacteria, then, you know, it's not going to be hundreds of years. But in humans, it's going to be hundreds of years because that's what takes multiple generations to act out. But that has nothing to do with epigenetics and nothing to do with gene expression. That's about natural selection acting on the existing amount of mutations, the existing variability, to change the proportions over time in the population. But that has nothing to do with you. That's about the proportions in the population. So these are just fundamentally different things. Let me summarize that. So gene expression is about epigenetics. You have cyclical things that act on the time frame of the cyclicality that are reversed as easily as they're imposed. Those can be short scale like the fasting feeding cycle, or they can be longer scale like seasonal changes in environment. And then you have things that would be expected to impact at least, you know, a life cycle, if not generations, that will act primarily through the state of the mother's body and the child's body during pregnancy, nursing, and development. And those are large-scale things like long famines or changes in food availability. And then you have environment will immediately and always be affecting the rate of mutation. And then on the variability caused by that mutation, natural selection will act over generations, but will not act on you. Natural selection acts on you by killing you. So natural selection acts on a population by killing some people more than others, which is complemented by sexual selection, which acts to make some people have more children than others. And that has no effect on gene expression in an individual, but has strong effects of the proportions of certain SNPs in a population over time as played out over generations. Okay, I hope that helped.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, where I hold monthly private Zoom Q&As for my members. The MasterPass also serves as a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. If you'd like to participate in these Q&As, you can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for 10% lifetime discount. I am currently working full-time on finishing my first book, Vitamins and Minerals 101, How to Get the Nutrients You Need on Any Diet. I will let you know when I have a release date. In the meantime, you can pre-order the book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet, has been newly released as version 1.3. This is my comprehensive system for managing nutritional status with lab tests, dietary analysis, and comprehensive intake of your signs and symptoms. The new version has a comprehensive guide to interpreting the Genova methylation panel. You can pick up your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. Please consider supporting my work at no extra cost to you by visiting my support page and making a purchase with one of my affiliate links. Some of my most popular affiliates are also listed in the description of this video with links that will give me credit for your purchase. I will try to respond to comments when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.